It's great. And today I would like to tell you about the performance. Usually then we speak about performance, we need to think about working with database, because we have usually a huge request to working with database. And in this case, we have the neural places with working with database, usually performance is degraded. Knowing how to increase database performance can be one of the most important customer service tools in your toolbox. I'm going to tell you shortly about the performance optimization model, optimization strategy, indexing strategy. I give you a few tips to improve query performance. Also, we speak about some words about execution plan, entity framework, core performance optimization. And also, I'm going to give you a real example of the performance optimization plan, which I created in scope of working on optimization when application during my work. You can see the performance optimization model. Application users like then they don't have to stare at the loading icon for a long time, and then everything is clear and fast. Using the technique which described in this material allows to improve the performance of the database, which will have a positive impact on the user experience. The optimization process starts from the bottom, from the schema design, and moves up throughout each level on top. In my practice, usually I use the only that level which are in the middle of this model, because usually then I have optimization task. The schema design was already created, and it is not allowed to change it, and so on. And usually I used the query optimization, indexing, sometimes locking, and very rarely server turning. And today I'm not going to speak about turning server and so on. And let's go. For the our optimization, we need to choose optimization strategy. And what strategy can you use? What should be investigated? What should be verified? You can decide it. You can create optimization strategy and try to throughout one by one in this strategy. You can see the example. And in this example, you can see a few points which we which I described to you in the next few slides. And for now, I would like to say a few words about the temporary tables and about the using statement exist. As for temporary tables, sometimes it's very useful to use the temporary tables instead the large your native tables, which has a lot of fields and properties. And instead, you can create the temporary tables, and you can increase the complexity query in this case, because you have a low quantity of the rows, and you can improve performance database by transferring your data to a temporary table, and after making join to the temporary table instead the your table, your original table. At the same time, if you have the strict and very clear query, it is not useful to use temporary tables, and that's why I would not recommend the use temporary table. It is not really needed for some complexity queries. About the use existing. If you need to check for the existence of records, it is better to use existing instead the operator count. Where you use count, you go throughout whole table, whole column, and it can be took a lot of time, and operator exists stop the his action after the first matching is found. You need also use the indexes. Indexes provide faster access to data for operation, then return a small portion of the table's row. Indexing create a data structure, then help keep you all data organized and make it easy to local information. Because it's easy to find data, indexes increases and efficiency the data retrieval and speed up the entire process, saving both you and the system time and effort. You can create an index of any column, and in this case, in case that column is not used, it will be using resources on using you will waste the resources in this case, and it is not needed. And please be careful with it. You only need to use indexes for columns which are used in the application. Typically, you insert or load data into table before the creating indexes. And if your table a frequently used operator insert, update, or delete, you need to use indexes carefully because it can lead to performance degradations. And signs after performing the above operations, all indexes should be recreated and must be changed. And it should be balanced between the need useful the using indexes and also about the real application needs. The next tip of way correlated SQL subquery. It's more clear and understandable that you don't need to use something like select all from the any tables, because sometimes the tables has a lot of fields, and in this case, maybe you need only three of them. And it sounds very simple, but if you consider a table with hundreds of columns and million of rows, if your application really needs a few columns, that is no point to querying all the data. This is huge waste of resources. Some words about execution plan. Usually, then we diagnose database performance using tool, and then we use SQL SQL Server Management Studio. Usually, you investigate execution plan for SQL queries. This is very useful, and request should not take more a lot of time, and usually it's not take more than 50 milliseconds. Investigate execution plan help to understand what really happened with your query under the hood. Query execution plan is a sequence of operation required to obtain the result of the SQL query, and you can show during your investigation which indexes are used, which join methods are select, nested loops or hash join or union. And also you can see how the results are grouped, ordered, and so on. Take your time to understand how the optimizer works and write queries in such a way that it can help you, not harm you. Also, it's important to remember that you should use the correct data types in your query. SQL server can implicitly cast one data type to another. And really, you can see an example that you use the integer type, and also you can use the string not string in the database, it should be varchar also. And then you perform the conversion on the column in the where statement or in join condition, you will always see a table's scan during the conversion. Since you cast in the values stored in the column to compare you used in the condition, the index will not be used. And really, I placed in the picture the execution plan for this short query. And you can see that really we cannot use index if we don't have a correct data type in the our query. SQL query.
Sorry, may I ask one question?
Yes.
But is this correct that we have select with where number, but have scan for it and seek for varchar? Probably vice versa, seek for number and scan for string.
It's a real example and depends on the what exactly type you use in the column. What I mean, if your type for the national ID number is integer, and maybe it's SQL, something like short, I mean that any numeric type, and you created index for the this field. In this case, you need to use integer. In my case, the national ID number is a string, because sometimes it's something like from the real example from the one of the database from USA, and it's usually it's a string, because sometimes we can use inside the national ID number the letters. And case, so it was in alphabetical ordering, and the index was created by the alphabetical order in the column national ID number, and that's why it's real example on my, it was implemented on my machine, and that's why I know that it's correct. And really, it is correct. At the same time, maybe it can be something like count of the attempt to, I don't know, attempt to log in, and it should be down 1, 2, 3, and so on.
With your comment that national ID number is a string, now it's clear why we have such results. Okay, thanks.
Yeah, please. Welcome. Next statement, which I recommended use, avoiding coding loops. It's interesting thing because sometimes it happened in real code, and you can see that SQL query in this case inside the loop. What it means? It means that this query will run a lot of times, for example, 1000 in this case. And if you think about how many time need to do such query, you realize that it is not a wrong way to work with it. The query inside loops are bad, and that often number of iteration depends how many object also another query returns. And with a small amount of data, your loop probably can run fast. But then you end up with a lot of data. It will start become slowly and slowly. And in this case, it is not our approach. And we need to change it and use inside the maybe storage procedure or maybe in function the usual statement, which we use for a set of data in the SQL. In the SQL. Next. It's my favorite. It's about cursor. In my practice, I faced with a lot of using cursors in the stored procedure. It was a huge degradation of performance, and it was the most important thing which we find during the our procedure optimization of the performance of our application. And it's extremely important understand what is Cursor and why you need to use it. I should say that it's very rarely that you need usage Cursor in your storage procedure and so on. Usually it's it is not needed to use the Cursor in the application, and usually it's enough to use a set of data which typically return SQL query. Cursors are commonly used by developers which used to write line by line processing, and it's important to remember that it is not a code. I mean that it is not our likely loops. It's SQL queries, and it works like a set of data. In this case, the performance is very, very low. And sometimes some of storage procedure can have the Cursor insights. And usually such procedures run in the middle of the night to do some work because it's very low performance for it. About entity framework. What I would like to describe in this case. The first of all, I would like to say about use as node tracking. This is new for me that in entity framework core, this feature will reproduce, will renew such it has the entity framework 6. And then you run a query of some entity in your DB context, the returned object automatically tracking. And it's sometimes useful because changes which you do during the work with application can be safe with context with context, and usually you need to know what exactly are using during the your actions. What I mean, sometimes you need only read-only query in the returned for returned data, and it is not necessary to have context perform some extra work to establish that tracking. And sometimes you need to use as no tracking method tells entity framework to stop do additional work, and it can improve the performance of application. And what you need to do, you need to analyze what exactly in what places and what targets your query are used, and after use or no use as no tracking method. Usually it appeared to the 1.5 times faster use as no tracking than with tracking. Another statement, avoid fetching all the fields if it is not required. It's pretty simple, specify fields which are needed instead of the selection all fields. It's something like about select all, yeah? And please pay attention also how many pages, how many records can be used and should be displayed for user, for example. Because sometimes in the application, we can see all huge data loaded to the during working in backend, and it is not a great solution because paging can be not for size 10, also it can be for 5 and so on. And sometimes if it's, for example, mobile application, user can see only two records on his display, and it should be investigated, and we need to use only real needed values for page, for records, and so on. Another thing that lazy loading. For now, in the entity core, we can see this feature again, and it will get a huge performance blow with such code, which you can see in example. And you can see that lazy loading use in this case for order, and after we load customer, and after for customer, we load the properties and use it, and so on. Instead, you can use a statement include and use age loading and add the, and as I said, include the should be in this request. What interesting that one plus n queries will be processed in the first example, and only one query in the example second. It's important thing. Another point. I also see such approach in the during my work. This is the using pattern proxy in your application. Sometimes the user cannot use all of data. And for example, you have a view of list view with list of patients or maybe orders or something like this. Usually this is a large object with a lot of properties and information inside. And you can see on your display only a few columns and a small portion of information. You didn't load all fields, just create simple proxy object to display. After user selection, such row record can be loaded fully in the separate view, and you can in this case optimization will be amazing, and you can try to use if it's no happened else. And the at the end performance optimization plan. It's a plan. It's a real example, and what we did. Then we have a task of optimization. First of all, you need to diagnose database performance using tools. In our case, we use SQL Server Management Studio. Analyze and then optimize execution plans SQL query. The request should not take more than 50 milliseconds. It is not obviously, it can be more or less. It's real plan and go. The next point, delete unused indexes. It very important sometimes because we have a lot of indexes for fields which are not used ever in our application, and after this removing, the application will work faster and faster. Add hints to SQL query to avoid blocking in the database. Oh, this is the about this is something like also next, check a set week log level for database and entity framework transaction. What I mean, that it is needed to set with no log for your query if it is not, if it's select statements, because the default transaction isolation level in the SQL Server is read commit isolation level, and in this retrieving the change in data will be blocked until the changes are commit. And with no log table, hint is used to override the default transaction isolation level. on the table and with a view specific table and allows user to retrieve data without being affected by lock. And if somebody is changed this table, you can also select for reading your data and it will be faster. Sometimes it can be allowed, but not always. And you can use it in many cases. At complex composite indexes for most frequently used tables and according to these most frequent queries. It's about the indexing strategy, indexing, and we add a lot of indexes for our tables, and it was a complexity index with a few columns inside, and it works faster. Add to the caching date, add the caching for long queries and optimize object to cache. It's sometimes very useful to use caching and as well as using asynchronous operations, as I point in the nine statement. Sometimes it is that we have data which are not very fast changed, and caching in this case will be used for improving speed of our application. And also, it was our finding we add redundant tables in the database, and we did denormalize the usual database. It is not ordinary approach for doing such functionality. At the same time, the application will work faster and faster because sometimes we need only username in a lot of queries, and the table of users has a lot of information with user, a lot of some codes and another information. And in this case, we need only name of user, and we add this name for all tables, and it works faster. And also, we rewrite stored procedure to optimize execution time. This is very individually, and you need to investigate execution plan in each query to understand what should be done in scope of this. Because for now, automatically, you cannot create SQL query which will use so fast as you need it. And that's why it is the procedure which need your attention. And it seems like that's all from my side about the performance optimization database. And maybe you have questions, I'm ready to answer.